building was designed by some random contractors that the state got. It has in no way been designed by ERE faculty. It was intended initially to be act as a passive solar building with two layers of windows, and it ended up not working very well because it got too hot. And so they tried to add different ventilation systems with it. But the main thing is it was not designed by anybody on the engineering faculty at HSU. And we were not allowed to actually try to fix it. There were several faculty that, as the building was going up, recognized some of the potential problems with it, and they didn't want their input.
So,
even worse.
We didn't want to do
it. So,
we're going to work here, but you're not going to let us say anything about
exactly.
it.
Exactly. Even though we're engineers that have this as our specialty in
okay.
terms of you know, renewable energy
yeah.
and alternative energy designs.
Yes.
And then, you know, as you enter the building, it always looks like maybe we keep a bunch of live animals or something here. but normally, we just want to keep you away from engineering students and throw them in behind the fence.
That's not true.
What you see as you walk in and come out and get a look at this is this big, long structure here is what we call a flume. And it's used to do research on channels that convey water. We can also fill it up with gravel and sediment, and we can model riverbeds. And so we use it in some of our classes to look at river engineering and river restoration design. We also use it for sediment transport experiments. And then we also use this area for storage of equipment that we use for field work.
Physically, and we model by computers, so this is one method for us to model because we work with the environment, so we have to simulate the environment by using models. So groundwater, we can't really make a model that models groundwater, so we have to use computers and models, computer models to model those. So this is one tool in our toolbox.
We call it our fishbowl. Students just gather there and work together in groups and doing homework and things, and the student group does a coffee table most mornings. They sell bagels and coffee and tea and everything, snacks for students.
Just like the one in Science B in the wildlife building.
Exactly, just like anything else. We have our own machine shop and equipment technician here. So a lot of our experiments, we need to build things that are just specially made for those experiments or for class projects. And the equipment technician can do that out of a variety of different materials. So he's available for both research projects and for class projects if something needs to get built.
Yep.
And if there is somebody that you have on a tour that's really interested in engineering, you can always suggest to them that they can just walk through here. After the tour, while they're just visiting on campus, a lot of the posters you see up are class projects or research projects that mm-hmm. students have presented either to each other or to the public. They do a lot of work that has clients that are either public agencies or cities. And so it's a good place to just kind of walk through and look at some of the posters and see what people have worked on. Both experiments and instruction at the same time. So for example, in here, we call this our materials lab because we've got this big machine, even though it looks like it's very ancient and old, which it is, it's still quite functional. But basically, it's designed to break things.
Oh, fun.
And it's designed to break things, but then measure what forces it took to break them. And so an example is breaking things like concrete cylinders and figuring out whether you designed your concrete well enough. Did you add enough sand? Did you add enough water? Did you cure it? And then it can also pull things apart. So other materials, you might be interested in what it takes to break them by pulling them instead of pushing on them. And then students will actually build structures, bridges, trusses, roofs, things like that, and see how much force they can take. And that we can use that machine for that.
Cool.
And let's say we need a book on wastewater or electronics or whatever, then here's our own little engineering library that we have, we come in and use at any time. And these are basically old books, but the fundamentals of engineering, physics, chemistry, biology, they don't really change year to year. So even though they're old, they still serve the purpose. So that's a really nice resource that a lot of students like to use.
Mm-hmm.
main computer labs. As Simeon mentioned, we do engineers in general and environmental engineers particularly simulate a lot of systems with computer models. And we evaluate our designs on the computer models first and make sure that we're pretty certain they're going to work. And then we go out and actually implement the designs. And so we've got a computer lab dedicated to the engineering students with appropriate engineering software for them. And then we've got what we call a design lab. It's got computers plus working space to like lay out plans and things like that.
We can kind of peek in.
Yeah, you can peek into this one.
Look what I'm making. It's a big bag.
Yay.
It's full of methane gas.
So they have all the software on here for us to use, and these computers don't shut down, so we're always in here. So we stay here all night, basically. It's very useful. And we have color printing as well, which is very nice.
Of course, because there is such a big demand for computers. There's even more.
So this is the data prep room, but it turns into the senior room. As you can see, it's full of seniors working on their senior project. And
they have first dibs on this
room. Yeah, we kick out the freshmen.
And if they don't spend enough time in this room, we lock them in.
Hey, hey.
What's she doing?
Doing a tour. Is it tour guide?
And then we also have.
Can you take a minute?
Oh, it's in here.
It should be here.
Yeah.
Come on in, guys. Take a look around. This is a.
This lab is reserved for working on special projects and working on research with faculty. And so one of the things one of our faculty does is he works on what's called advanced water treatment systems. Most of them are based on membranes, so I think some of you probably have heard of desalination and cleaning up salt water from the ocean to turn it into drinking water. The experiments that Dr. Achille does is looking at the best ways to do that and how to do that with the least amount of energy, because it does take a lot of energy to get salt out of ocean water to make it drinkable, as you might suspect.
Yeah.
And so you'll see his students in here running experiments. They build small-scale systems that are equivalent to what you would use in a real treatment plant, but you would scale it up and make it probably 1,000 times larger. So they test it at the small scale and then develop designs that can be implemented at the larger scale. And his students, you know, present their research. They've got interfaces between the experiment and the computer, so a lot of the experiments are computer operated, so they can run for a couple of days automatically, like a plant would, and be able to collect the data as it goes.
Yeah. And the microfiltration basically works that it's basically a thin layer, and it has holes in it, and the holes are so small that it will allow water to pass through water molecules, but it traps all the larger molecules, so like pharmaceuticals, heavy metals. So it's a good way, it basically filters the water on a microscopic level or atomic level. So expensive, but as technology goes up, it's going to become more and more feasible. Yeah.
The idea behind the blue energy, or it's called pressure retarded osmosis, is that if you've got one of the membranes that allows the water to pass through the membrane but not salt molecules, if you have on one side of that membrane, if you have salt water and the other side fresh water, it creates what's called an osmotic gradient. And if you've taken botany or something similar, you've known that. That's how plants can suck up water. But it also works moving the water through the membrane. So the water would have a tendency to move from the freshwater side to the saltwater side to dilute the saltwater. And what that does is it increases the volume on the saltwater side because it's moving the water molecules through. And then when that happens, you're elevating the water, and water with some elevation can be used to spin turbines or water wheels and generate energy. And so it's a device and mechanism that people are looking at now to generate energy essentially passively through this osmotic gradient.
probably the group that's the most advanced in doing it is a group in Norway that's been working on it for a couple of years at kind of a larger plant scale.
And so this is the main water quality lab that's used for teaching. And so students in our program learn how to do water quality testing. They use it to evaluate whether wastewater treatment systems are working. They use it to evaluate local creeks and see what impacts might be changing the water quality. We do studies on stormwater, all kinds of things. It's kind of interesting, right, what they have out now, and we're getting ready to do some experiments with these. Is these are actually little fuel cells that the Schatz Energy Research Center designed, and they're designed for laboratory testing by classes. And so this is actually the fuel cell here, and when you plug it in, it generates hydrogen, and the hydrogen gas goes on one side, and then you've got oxygen being created. And so these allow students to play with fuel cells and look at how much energy they generate. We used this in our first class, Engineering 115, and then we use it again in our thermodynamics class, our first energy class, to look at the potential of energy generation using a single cell of a fuel cell. We use that as a good way to introduce students to the concept of fuel cells. It's distilling water.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, it's a distillation unit. You see it's boiling the water,
yeah,
and then it goes up and recondenses it, and that's the way we distill water for the lab.
Yeah. We have a large supply of distilled water for our experiments, if we get thirsty.
So we do all the basic water quality testing of that you would use to evaluate the safety of drinking water and effectiveness of wastewater treatment.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got the full suite of figuring out what bacteria are in the water and things like that.
Yep.
Can you explain what a fuel cell is?
Yeah, a fuel cell is a way to combine the hydrogen and the oxygen, and it actually creates energy when you create the hydrogen gas and you connect the hydrogen and the oxygen together, and they form a water molecule that creates energy, and it's a way to take advantage of that and give that back out. So when you hear people talk about hydrogen as a fuel, they're using a fuel cell to get that energy.
Isn't there an alternate where they use it as a combusting gas?
They do use hydrogen as a combusting gas. One of the things that people are a little bit hesitant to use that on a large scale is because it's so combustible.
Yeah. Hindenburg, but
there are some examples, yes.
And the engineering students here designed the first hydrogen fuel cell vehicles, right? Oh, God. Can you elaborate
on that? They've done a lot to advance the efficiency of the fuel cells, but they didn't design the first one.
Okay.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Like the second and the third one, maybe?
You're going to have to get the CERC
okay.
folks for that history.
Okay. And Chevron paid for our hydrogen refueling station to go on this campus, right?
Correct.
Okay.
That was a grant from, it was a mix of people, but Chevron was one of the main backers.
Okay.
And the history of the hydrogen fueling station is that it started out as a design competition by the Hydrogen Fuel Association, I think it is, but I can look that up for you. And it was a student design competition. Our group of HSU engineering students entered the design competition and won first place. And so they were invited to the conference to present their design results and receive their prize. And a representative from Chevron was in the audience listening to their presentation and really liked the ideas. And so they said, hey, we're going to give you some money to improve the design. They worked with Chevron. They worked with engineers at the Schatz Energy Research Center, and most of the groups of students continued, and they came up with design improvements and a final design, and then they got the money to build the station.
Wow. All right.
Cool. And is it a national competition?
It's a national competition.
Okay.
Yep.
And are we the only
state school with a hydrogen fuel?
We are the only state school with a hydrogen fueling station.
Woohoo!
All right.
But there are other schools, I believe two other schools in the CSU that actually have fuel cell generators that power a significant portion of their campus.
Wow. Yes. Okay.
Northridge is one, and I believe the other is Pomona.
Oh, wow.
I can see Pomona.
Yeah, today. Wow. And this filling station is open to the public?
No.
It's only open?
It's not open. It's used by shots in a couple other people.
Okay. Yeah.
It's not currently open to the public.
Are they planning on opening it to the public anytime?
You'll have to ask them.
Okay. It's good to know.
Another script update.
There have been, special occasions where they knew a vehicle was coming through,
mm-hmm.
and they made arrangements. But right now, I don't. The last I again, you should get this information from CERC because I'm not them. But I think the last time I talked to them about the closest hydrogen fueling station, and here, it wasn't quite far enough to be sure that your vehicle can make it.
It was kind of a stretch. Okay.
Yeah.
Huh. And we have two hydrogen fuel cell vehicles on campus? Or
We have.
Okay.
And the hydrogen fuel cell vehicles that they have on campus is a cooperative research program with Toyota.
Oh.
So they've been Toyota vehicles, and they're outfitted so that you can query them and see how they're working and with all their performance. And so they drive them for a while, they send data back and forth between CERC and Toyota, and the vehicles occasionally go back to Toyota and cycle through so they can look at the wear and tear on them and download performance data. So I'm not sure what the status is of both of them right now. Okay. I know one was older and a newer one was just pinned on campus and they were both there at the same time. But I don't know if they're both still here right now.
Yeah, I've seen them around on campus.
If they're, you could see, the place to see them is and count them is they're always parked in plant operations when they're not being used.
Okay.
The rainwater that's running off this building and it stores it right there. So
and treats it with wetland treatment.
Yeah.
So it was just purposely like designed. Just like the marsh.
It's a mini marsh, yeah.
It's a mini marsh that was designed.
Ah, good job. All connected.
It's designed for stormwater treatment.
Did engineers have any part with that?
Or yes. Bob Gearhart wanted to meet you. So this is our fluid mechanics lab. And in this room, we do a lot of experiments related to the movement of water.
Woo.
And the pressures, the flows, the characteristics of the water depth. The flume, this is our smaller flume. This one, we can't do the river designs that I was talking about before because we can't put dirt in this one.
Mm-hmm.
The other one's designed to take dirt. But we can change the slope, we can change the flow rate through it, and we can set up all different kinds of interesting hydraulics. And then we can look at how water moves through different pipes. We can take the pipes out here and put in new types, new materials, new configurations. And then we've got a lot of other little things that we can do. We cooperate with fisheries. This weird thing you see in the back here was actually it's a recirculating flume. And we're looking at how different animals attach to different surfaces, and we're trying to wash them off and see what velocities it took to do that. What you see down on the ground there,
mm-hmm.
that plexiglass thing,
yeah.
that's actually a model of a culvert. Anybody know where Luffenholtz Creek is?
Over by Luffenholtz Beach.
Over by Luffenholtz Beach. It drains right onto the beach. That is actually a 1:15 scale model of the culvert for Luffenholtz Creek under Highway 101 in Trinidad.
Wow.
It's a custom Caltrans design with the arches like that. And so we were looking at how we could modify that culvert to help fish swim through it.
This whole room is Margaret's specialty. This is her baby. Another really cool feature is that we learned how devastating water can be in pumps. This is cavitation. when pumps spin too fast, it actually damages the pump. So it's really cool to actually see what happens. So
this is the inside of a pump. This was all solid metal. Cavitation is collapsing bubbles that actually will pull metal molecules off the surface and over time just basically eat it away.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Water.
Just water itself spinning too fast.
Good old water.
No, if you go onto YouTube, you can just look up cavitation and shrimp, and you can see shrimp making cavitation
bubbles. Can you put this in your bag?
Yeah. The mantis shrimp.
Mantis shrimp.
It beats up everything in the ocean.
It's the same mechanism.
Shrimp. That's what it's doing?
It's creating a cavitation bubble.
Okay.
Yeah. Basically, it's moving so fast, it pushes the water away in the water. And that thing over there, in the far right corner,
that's
to model water going underneath the dam. So we use that in my wastewater treatment class. No, hydrology.
Hydrology.
We were in here once.
But yeah, we use that to model, we'll just visually see and model how water underneath the dam will go underneath the ground and come back up in front of the dam, continue a small stream. So we saw that with our own eyes. It was amazing. We all couldn't believe it. And we used the pink dye
to represent the water movement.
Yeah.
Yep.
The water movement. It'll be hard to see water moving. Because we had to dye it so we could see it.
Mm-hmm. Non-radioactive. And this whole floor is basically designed to capture.
Yeah, this
water.
Is well, the water we use in here is recycled. So there's a reservoir here.
Man, you will drown.
And we pump the water through different things in the room. We swap that out once or twice a year, and so we don't use fresh water for every experiment and waste a lot of water.
Nice.
You gotta conserve your water.
You see all these cans with holes in them? They've been wet a little bit too long. One thing you can do with what we call physical models is you can make measurements on a small scale model and figure out something about larger scale. But it's not just, okay, this diameter is, you know, five times less, so it's going to be five times different. There's actually different physical relationships, and they may not be readily apparent. So we use this to teach that, how you would scale up. Let's say we filled this with water and timed how long it took to drain. Can you use that measurement to predict how long it would take to drain this? You can, but it's not going to be just the time amount, like for the diameter difference. You've got to do some additional analysis. So it's kind of an experiment we use.
You don't need that.
Oh.
You don't need that. You love the room.
Reconfigurable, and it's got good solar access. So we've had it full of different solar panels for a while. We were running an experiment where we had different manufacturers' solar panels all run in parallel to compare their efficiencies and performance. Right now, we've got just our experimental module. So we use this. This is a solar hot water design, and we use this in classes to look at efficiency. Solar hot water, and then we also bring up a lot of what we call photovoltaic cells to look at electricity generation from solar panels.
Mark, can you explain how this would work?
So the way this works is you would plumb it so that water would go in one side and out the other, and then you've got the glass panel on top and a darker color in the back. That sunlight comes through and it heats that darker material, and then that's in contact with the water.
It's like a black plastic?
But the actual material varies. You have to be pretty careful that you want something that's going to be stable in sunlight, so it's usually not a plastic
degrading.
Or a rigid plastic. It would be. And then you want something that is really good heat transfer properties, which is typically a metal. So they vary in construction, but that's the type of things that you're looking for.
These are the same things that we have on Redwood Hall and Sunset Hall. You see them walking by, it's the same things that they use.
Really? This is what's heating up my showers?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good job.
Or at least part of the way.
Yeah.
When the sun out. Enough sun.
But even if you heat up the water partway, you reduce the fuel that you use to heat it the rest of the way. So that's good
all
use.
In the right direction. Like Margaret said, this is a good spot to get a lot of solar data because it's no trees and it's facing south, so it gets a lot of hours of sunlight.
Yeah.
So. I have a friend who's looking into solar energy. How big are our classes? How focused are we on solar energy as well as water energy? Like in the department?
Yeah.
So we do have solar energy areas as well?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we teach one whole class in solar thermal engineering, and then we teach another class in renewable energy power systems, which covers the solar electric engineering design.
And then, Margaret, do you know, just out of curiosity, are there a lot of undergraduate programs that actually focus that in-depthly on that kind of stuff? It's mostly grad work that starts to do that, right?
It's mostly grad work that gets into the design aspects of it.
Yeah.
Emphasis with this major. So like other engineers, you have to emphasize in a specific area of engineering. But here we have different classes that engineers can take. So using myself, for example, I have a lot of two water classes, wastewater treatment and water distribution and stormwater with Margaret. And I also took a solid waste class that basically taught me how to handle landfills. So I'm a water guy and I can handle solid waste. And I wouldn't be able to do that at other schools because I'd be strictly just water. So we give them the option by taking the classes. We have design electives. So they can pick three of them, and they can make it anything they want. It could be a water one, a renewable energy one, and a solid hazardous waste. Yeah, solid hazardous waste. And that way you could cover all three main aspects of environmental problems. So you could do a little bit of everything. So that's unique about this program, and you can stay on the tour as well. Environmental Resources Engineering is also called ERE. They're the same thing.
Yeah,
that's the only type of engineering that we have here. So we have no civil, we have no electrical, we have no College of Engineering. It's the only type of engineering that we have.
Okay.
And other schools have it the exact opposite.
Which of our colleges is it actually in?
College of Natural Resources.
Okay.
Yeah. So you might get that question. Also, I'll just ask, environmental engineering students do not have to go to graduate school. We can just find jobs just with a bachelor's degree. Some jobs might request or might require us to have an engineering and training certificate. And it's basically to get that certificate, you are required, or the students are required to take an 8-hour engineering exam. And our students do pretty well on that. I passed it the first time and several.
Usually well over 90% pass rate. The last couple of years it's been pass rates between 90% and 95%.
Wow.
And that's thanks to Margaret's awesome teaching.
Woo! Yeah, awesome professor.
She pounds it into it. You're not
awesome
gonna fail that exam.
which is higher than average in CSU.
So we're very proud about that. So our students are basically well trained to be engineers by the time they graduate. And that's because we have so much hands-on learning experience that we know the concepts of engineering. We know the fundamentals of engineering.
So this is the hydrogen fueling station. It's operated by the Schatz Energy Research Center. And it all got started as part of the hydrogen design competition I told you about that a group of ERE students entered and won. And so they were invited down to the conference to make a presentation. Their presentation was heard by engineers at Chevron, and Chevron was interested in developing the concept design, and so they gave us the Schatz Energy Research Center some money to finalize the design. So they worked with Chevron engineers, some of the students that were working on the project, and then they also helped fund it. It was a joint funding. There was funding by a number of different agencies that helped. There's the big list there on the back of the
brochure.
And they've continued to, operate it and make improvements. And basically, it's a proof of concept of what a hydrogen fueling station would look like and how the different components would work together.
Are hydrogen vehicles popular? Like, is that something that's...
They're not available production yet. For personal vehicles. There are a number of bus fleets and other, public fleets that have them. So that's the main source right now. Toyota, I think the last I read about it, was expecting to have one available for the public in 2 years. They have well-developed prototypes, obviously, because Schatz has been driving them around for a couple of years. But they're not yet selling them, you know.
I heard that was one of the things with our fleet that we have, with the Fora that we have, that they were basically, Toyota was like, test them for us.
That's what it's all about.
So you guys got a little technology? Test it.
Mm-hmm. Do you know the energy efficiency comparison between hydrogen fuel and natural gas?
For the fuel cells?
Yeah.
No, not off the top of my head.
Well, we check a little bit.
Because I know natural gas cars are becoming much more available. My mom has one.
Right.
And we have a bunch of buses around where I'm
right.
from.
They definitely produce a lot less pollution, and they do a better conversion than, you know, your liquid gasoline. But I don't know in terms of pollutants that they emit, the hydrogen fuel cells don't emit any CO2, where the natural gas still does, which is our main greenhouse gas.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's just significantly.
I think
it's significantly less because they are more efficient.
Yeah.
Well, and also it's the form of energy that's being used is renewable energy.
Yeah.
It's water.
Yeah.
Right.
And it exhausts the water.
Well, actually, what happens to the water after it's
it emits only water from their
vapor?
Tailpipes.
Is it water vapor?
It's water vapor, yeah. Or drips out.
It
depends
so then
on
it goes back
how
up
cool
into the
goes.
Environment, really. So, I don't know.
No, yeah, but water vapor goes up, it comes back down as rain.
So it is renewable.
It's
natural gas, it's one and done, baby.
Renewable, yay.
You need energy to originally generate the hydrogen.
See, that's and that was the original premise for all the work at CERC. That was the first funding that they got, was to figure out and build a demonstration system that renewably created hydrogen. And that's what's up at the Trinidad Marine Lab. There's solar panels that create electricity that run the electrolyzer that breaks the hydrogen off the water to create the hydrogen fuel cell. So that's still one of their main interests, is how do we make hydrogen, which is a really good fuel, how do we make it sustainably with renewable resources or renewable methods? So this particular plant and demonstration plant doesn't do that. It uses electricity off the grid right now.
Yeah.
But that would really close the loop if you're making hydrogen with electricity that is
renewable,
and solar is probably the most reasonable.
Once you get that down, then you see more hydrogen fuel cell cars on the street.
And the big benefit too is, and the reason you like to couple those two, is because if you're using solar to crack the water and get your hydrogen, you now have something you can store, and then you have energy to get back when the sun's not shining. So that's the real attraction to using that and coupling it with something like solar or wind that's not there all the time.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Yeah. It's kind of like just a random question, but do you know how much it takes to build like an actual gas station? Because it just gives you the facts of to build this was about 700,000 and then about 250,000 to upgrade. Since the building, so that's not very much, I feel like, compared to, but I don't know how much gas stations cost.
Yeah, gas stations, so much of the gas station cost is
tanks.
You got the tanks and the requirements for the tanks and everything, but also the location. It varies so much with location because of the price of land, so really hard to say.
How much would a gallon of hydrogen fuel cost then? Like, what's the... I know it's not like super commercialized.
Per kilogram.
Yet,
yeah, exactly. It should be
a month.
Well, this can make, it said like 2.5 kilograms a day.
$10.
So $10.
That's making it
$10 per kilogram.
$10 per kilogram. That is,
I have no idea if that is.
Mark.
Somebody bust out your phone. Find out kilograms to miles conversion.
Yes, the other thing is that energy content is very different. So you can't just say you can't just convert the kilograms to
well, you could, but it.
But it wouldn't be.
Magic and witchcraft, I say.
I'm just curious, like, if somebody asked me how much it would cost to fill up.
you say? Yeah. That's a good question.
Let's go through research.
Google. Yeah, I don't have a school here. Can I explain the marsh?
Yeah.
Very vague.
What participation do the engineering students have with that?
So they're at the marsh, we have what's called the Arcata Marsh Research Institute. And the original design for Arcata's wastewater treatment system in the marsh based on the constructed wetlands and what we call the treatment wetlands, which is also the natural habitat restoration that happens in that area, are using the treated wastewater. That was developed by professors in fisheries and engineering. And Professor Bob Gearhart was very instrumental in that, George Allen and Stan Harris. And now, Professor Gearhart is retired, and he and another professor in our department, Professor Finney, they have research, what they call the Arcata Marsh Research Institute. They work with the city of Arcata and masters and undergraduate students, and they look at the performance of the water treatment at the wastewater treatment at the marsh, and then they do system upgrades and system modifications. So they look at, oh, what if we change, you know, the planting patterns of plants here, or the water pattern, or how the water flows through the system, do we get better wastewater treatment? And so they use parts of the marsh itself. There's some what we call pilot cells and test cells that they can use. They monitor the operation of the wastewater treatment at the marsh itself, and then they have adjacent to the treatment plant or in the treatment ponds is they have tanks they can use, and they pump water out from different areas, and they can reconfigure those tanks to look at potential changes to the treatment system and evaluate those. So that's a really good source of a lot of master's thesis and student projects as well.
If you haven't been down there, I suggest you go down there. It's a really good opportunity to see it. It would make more sense if you saw it, and it's jogging trails all throughout that. And yep. It's very sanctuary.
My question is, what exactly does wastewater mean?
Wastewater? Anything you flush down the toilet or goes down the drain and gets collected by pipes and is sent to a wastewater treatment plant so that it gets taken care of appropriately and treated to a level that won't impact the environment when it gets released to the environment.
So is it safe to say that Arcata's sewer water goes
to
the marsh?
That is sewer water, and wastewater are the same thing.
Okay,
yes.
Do you guys know that? Yeah. Probably Humboldt States, too, goes to the marsh.
Humboldt States goes to the marsh. All of Arcata, all of Humboldt.
And internationally, is there any influence for the marsh internationally, or does it have impacts on people internationally?
It does. It's a nice, low-cost, low-maintenance design that provides a very good quality treatment, and it's especially useful in areas where you don't have a high level of technical expertise and that you can achieve really high quality wastewater treatment without having that.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of places where the marsh-based treatment systems have been implemented for that reason. There's been exchange programs with faculty and students here, with Mexico, Costa Rica, a group in Nicaragua, so that it's that those systems have been implemented.
Is that the Kamwapa?
The Kamwapa
is different, right?
Different. They haven't done a marsh treatment system. They're working more on their waters.
Rainwater
right
filtration?
Now. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really interesting. One other question. I haven't looked at my phone, so I'm not sure about the time. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to ask about, I know a lot of kids always ask us, what about study abroad? And people mm-hmm. who want to do engineering, I know that Lonnie
mm-hmm.
does a lot of work with, outside of the United States mm-hmm. and getting engineering students or all students experience doing appropriate technology projects, incorporating engineering principles. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so Lonnie's program in the Dominican Republic is really geared towards students between their freshman and sophomore years. It's a summer program, and it gets them 3 units of engineering credit, plus some GE credit and Spanish language credit, depending on where they are in their Spanish language. That's a really good opportunity. My other recommendation for engineering students is that they've been really successful at finding study abroad opportunities if they can find a program that has engineering courses, because especially in the sophomore and junior year, engineering programs pretty much all have the same basic engineering science programs, and so those transfer really easily. So if they have a particular country of interest, we've had students go to South Africa, Puerto Rico, Australia, France, Spain, etc.